talking the government. You know, if you're talking about the preachers and the people that's running the community, and we have to show them the evolution of where we come from. I'm about to send a message to the world, like.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to this year's 34th annual Cultural Rhythm Celebration. My name is Genesis.
And my name is Jenna.
And contrary to our names and our outfits, we are not biological sisters.
And neither one of us is the main reason that you're here.
Not even you, Mom?
But we are so excited to be here today to honor the Harvard Foundation's Artist of the Year, Janet Mock.
Cultural Rhythms is a time for dialogue, performance, art, and inspiration. This year's theme, Reclamation, shows us how people in our community and beyond Harvard, the Harvard sphere, are revolutionizing the way that we think about autonomy and taking up space.
And when we're thinking about reclamation, who better to show us the power of storytelling and the importance of combating stigma than feminist activist, host, and writer Janet Mock? Born in Hawaii, Janet Mock is a New York Times best-selling author who has written two memoirs, Surpassing Certainty and Redefining Realness.
She is the first trans woman of color to write and produce and direct a television series through her work with Pose. And in 2018, she was named by Time one of the 100 most influential people in the world.
We couldn't be more grateful to be here to honor her today. But before we get started, I need all of you to give a cultural and rhythmic welcome to the director of this year's Cultural Rhythms, Hakeem Angulu.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the 34th annual Cultural Rhythms. My name is Hakeem Angulu. I take the he series as my pronouns. I'm a junior in Winthrop House here, and I'm the director of this year's Cultural Rhythms. 34 years ago, the students and staff of the Harvard Foundation for Intercultural and Race Relations saw a glaring problem on this campus. Although Harvard was getting more diverse on paper, the symbols and spaces of this university bolstered its homogeneous history. It was rare to find a performer or group of performers who wanted to express and celebrate their culture publicly, but also had the means to reserve a space like Sanders Theater or draw an audience like you all. So they created the program that you see before you, Cultural Rhythms. It's a program that has immense meaning to me and to many students on this campus. This is my third year working on it. I started my first year as a stage manager. Last year, I directed the dialogue series with Katie Okumu, and now I'm the director. I'm an international student from Kingston, Jamaica. Hi, Mom, who is watching this live stream from home. And I'm half Nigerian. Student groups like the Harvard Caribbean Club and the Harvard Nigerian Students Association have provided me homes away from home. And programs like Cultural Rhythms have shown me the power of public and proud cultural celebration. And Cultural Rhythms is just that, celebration. It's not simply a disjoint set of performances for your viewing pleasure, I'm sorry. The theme for this year is reclamation. We've worked very hard to ensure that this year's iteration focuses on giving these performers that you'll see today the space to continue doing the critical work that they have been doing in service of their communities. The diversity that we bring to these spaces belongs to us and is in our service, not anyone else's. For one day through this show, for one month through Cultural Rhythms, and for all year through the work of the Harvard Foundation, we proclaim proudly that we belong here and that our diversity is our strength. I've had the honor of serving as this year's director, but I have a massive team supporting this production. The intern team at the Harvard Foundation is quite literally my family. And they've been crucial to my support system at this college and throughout the planning process for this production. I also want to extend a special thank you to the administrators and staff involved with the foundation, everyone from our programming fellow, Haley Harris, to our administrative coordinator, Sonia David, and to our amazing interim director, Joan Rouse, who I'd briefly like to thank. Thank you, Joan. The show wouldn't have been possible without our wonderful production team, professional light and sound technicians, and Sanders Theater staff, all of whom I've had the pleasure of working with and getting to know over the past 3 years. But Culture Rhythms extends beyond this show. We had a fantastic month-long dialogue series where we sat down and had discussions about current events and topics surrounding inclusion and justice. Everything from a panel on queerness and religion to a guided tour through the African clay art exhibit at the Harvard Art Museums. All of that served the purpose of having students at this college interrogate their place and the structures that exist here and beyond here, all led by our wonderful Jess Arian and Aaron Abai. Hopefully, some of you were also able to make it out to our artist conversation and the luncheon led by Winona Guo and Irene Wu, the two first years who have been committed to this work since stepping on this campus only a few months ago. All of these forms of programming, culminating in this beautiful show, are in the service of the mission of the Harvard Foundation: to improve relations among racial and ethnic groups within the university and to enhance the quality of our common life. Not only do we seek to celebrate the diversity of cultures on this campus, but more importantly, we want to cultivate it and complicate it, to ask questions that ought to be asked, and to move with purpose towards actions that make our communities better. Dr. S. Allen Counter, the founding director of the Harvard Foundation, lived and breathed this mission while he was with us. This program and everything it represents is his legacy. He committed his life. He committed his life and career to amplifying the voices of students of color. In fact, when I came to Visitas, the first time I stepped in this theater was to watch one of his lectures about his work reuniting an indigenous family. His work means a lot to me, and without it, I can guarantee that I would not be up here today. This is the second iteration of Culture Rhythms without him, and I hope that he will be proud of what we've done. So, on to the program. We have 12 performers for you this evening, and I hope you're excited to see what they've prepared. Their art is an extension of themselves, so I'm begging you to treat it with the respect and reverence that it deserves. This is the time to celebrate their beautiful and powerful work on the biggest stage that Harvard University has. And right after intermission, we'll be awarding our annual Artist of the Year Award to the phenomenal Janet Mock. Janet Mock is a brilliant writer, director, producer, and Black and trans rights advocate. Her work, with everything from her best-selling books, Surpassing Certainty and Redefining Realness, to writing and directing on FX's Pose, is powerful. Much more powerful than my simple words can describe. She is a heroine of mine, and I hope that the work that the foundation does can someday approach her own. With that, I'd like to invite Ms. Mock to the stage. Okay, great. I hope you all enjoy the show.
Are y'all ready? For real this time. Are y'all ready?
Please welcome our first performer to the stage, Emmy Semprun.
Casa en La Habana reservada para ti.
Wasn't that absolutely incredible?
Wow.
I guess you could say it was like an Emmy-worthy performance.
Jenna?
Yes?
Emmys are for television.
Speaking of television, are there any agents or producers or managers in the audience? Because I'm a writer myself.
All right. What did I tell you about tonight? It's about community, not advancing our careers.
I hear you. Speaking of community, let's turn to Emmy and Janet and see what's on your minds.
Oh, wow, I didn't know the word. Okay.
Yes.
I just thought that Emmy did an amazing job, obviously. Yeah. And then I love her flower.
Yes.
Thank you.
No, thank you so much. What does cultural rhythms mean to each of you?
Well, for me, I think it's just sort of a space where you get to share not only where you come from, but also what you identify with in where you come from, because it's not everything and it's not just one thing. And just being able to like express that art and what it means to you, and
I guess I would kind of think of it in a similar way, where it's kind of like the internal rhythm and heartbeat at which keeps us continuing on to be able to share ourselves, our people, our places, our things. And so I guess this is kind of like, I'm from Hawaii, so it's kind of like a mixed plate assortment of all of the various things that we bring to the table and to the stage.
So insightful.
Definitely. And now we're bringing to the stage the Harvard College Kumba Singers. So give it up for them.
Thank you.
Wasn't just that so beautiful? I mean, the power of voice, the power of singing. I just wanted to get up out of my seat and join them, but I can't sing, so.
But you know what we could do, Genesis? We could dance. In fact, we could start our own dance crew.
I don't know anything about that because we're not very coordinated, Jenna.
Well, okay, maybe we could learn from somebody else. Like maybe our next act, perhaps.
Yeah, why not?
Everybody, please welcome to the stage, A.
A.
D.
T. What a beautiful performance.
Certainly beautiful, and a lot more difficult than I thought it would be. I don't know if we're ready.
Do you think they need a water girl?
Hopefully. I think that might be our only way in. We've clearly got a lot to learn, so let's turn to our members of AADT and Janet. And I'm wondering if you could tell us a bit about what went into the planning of that performance and what is its significance?
Yeah, so we're AADT. We're one of the only non-audition dance groups on Harvard's campus. We have almost 200 members, and most of them have never danced before coming to college. So Flagship, that's what we call this dance. Flagship is the dance that we send to Cultural Rhythms every year. And Shira will talk more about.
Sure, so the dance that we're doing today is a Dai dance, and that's one of the 56 ethnic minorities in China. They're primarily based in southern China in the Yunnan province, and their dances typically depict parts of Mother Nature, so water, in our example, trees and the forest and the birds.
And really, what I really had to do to prepare for this performance was, just kidding, beautiful.
Thank you so much, AADT. And now we'd like to welcome to the stage another group, Harvard College Deepam.
Oh,
These performers are bringing in the heat.
I know, absolutely fire, flames, it's overwhelming. Deepam, can you tell us a little bit more about this dance and what it means to you?
Yeah, of course. So this dance is a Tilana, which is an expression of pure dance, so a lot of rhythmic footwork and things like that. And so we've been preparing for this dance for a few months now. It's choreographed by two of our own dancers.
Who designed your costumes, and what are these called? Because I need some of those.
So the costumes, most of us have been studying dance for a long time, since we were kids, so these are costumes that we've gotten from India over the years, so so that's the costume, and these, well, we call them Selenge, but they are also known as Gungrus. We actually just had a show last week with a lot of all the South Asian groups on campus, and it's called Gungru, actually. So, and so we performed this there as well. That's what these are.
Wow, great. Thank you so much. Stay in your seats, folks. We have more to come. Please give it up for our next act, Under Construction.
When did I become come so cold?
I'm paralyzed.
When did I become ashamed?
My pockets, waves come crashing over me, but I just watch them. I just watch them. I'm on the water, but I feel like I'm on top of it. I'm at the bottom, but I know where the problem is. I'm in a box, I'm gonna lock me in. Suffocating, I'm running out of oxygen.
Where are my feelings? I no longer feel things. I know I should. I'm paralyzed.
Construction fan club.
Yeah.
Whew. Are you doing okay?
I kind of feel overwhelmed. I don't know if it's safe to be here, Genesis.
What do you mean?
I mean, I don't know if Sanders Theater has the capacity to handle this talent. I think we might have to evacuate the building.
Nah, it's okay. We'll be fine.
I don't know. Do we have hard hats? The ceiling's gonna come down at any minute.
We don't, but Under Construction could probably help us with the power of music.
Yes, mm-hmm. Okay. Under Construction, yes. Tell us a little more about your musical influences.
Songs.
Yes, songs, choices, all of that stuff.
Yeah, for sure. So my name's Ethan. I'm a senior here at the college.
Hey.
So Under Construction is Harvard's Christian a cappella group. We just have the mission of sharing love with our campus and stories of transformation and faith through song. That might not be so obvious with the song that we performed today. It's Paralyzed by Enough, but the reason that we chose to perform that is because as a Christian group and as a faith group, we want to acknowledge that people in our positions don't always have it all together. I know sometimes it might seem like people are self-righteous or kind of full of themselves, which is not a good reputation to have. So part of what we try to do on campus with songs like Paralyzed is just share that vulnerability and the fact that sometimes we do feel upset and we have things in our lives that don't make sense to us and we feel paralyzed and stuck in our situations, but that's part of our lives too. And even though we sing happy songs and praise songs, we just want to share that with the campus as well.
Yeah. That's basically it. I'm Bruno, I'm also a senior at the college. We just really like to make our audience feel something very special, whether we sing to a group of, you know, of a faith community, whether it be at a church or at a venue, a beautiful venue like this. We just want to make sure that the audience can feel something and can really relate to this song in some way or another. So really the emotions that we show as we're singing this song are very personal and are very intimate, and we hope that we can bring the audience in with us as well. So thank you for allowing us to do that.
Yes. Janet, did you feel something?
Not a thing. no, I wanted to know what the meaning of the song was, and so Ethan broke that down.
Yes.
Yeah.
Great. I know that performance might have brought up a lot of feelings as it aimed to do, so I think this would be a great time for us to do a little breathing exercise. Genesis, if you could lead us,
yes,
please.
Yes, of course. All right, everyone. Take a deep breath in. And release. And another one. And release. Wow. I think we're just going to have to take a little break here because I can't handle it.
Yes. Break. I think we could think of it as an intermission, if you will.
That's what they're called.
Yes. Yeah. So you can go downstairs, maybe go to the bathroom where you may or may not find Genesis and I accepting donations. Fan clubs don't start themselves, and they don't start for free. Yeah, we'll see you in 15 minutes.
15 minutes, everybody. Thank you.
Just matters that I'm in love with you. It only matters that you.
Wasn't that an amazing tribute video?
Welcome back, everyone. Hope you're feeling recharged. If not, that's not my problem.
Nope.
Please direct all complaints to the next person to take the stage.
And now we welcome the director of the 34th Cultural Rhythm Celebration, Hakeem Angulu.
Hi again. I don't have much to say because Dean Carano will be following me to give this thing out. But thank you all for coming tonight. It really means a lot to me and the foundation team. I hope that you've enjoyed the performances that have come before now and that you will enjoy this award presentation and Janet Mock's speech and then the six or seven other performances that we have for you. So thank you. With that, I'll invite Dean Carano to come to the stage with some remarks.
So good evening, everyone. As Hakeem said, I'm Rakesh Khurana. I have the great fortune of being the dean of the college, and I just want to welcome everyone again to the 2019 Cultural Rhythms. Before I talk a little bit about our wonderful recipient of the award tonight, I want to just sort of give a huge round of applause to all the students who've worked so hard to put this program together. And I want to thank all the faculty, the administrators who are here. We have representatives from the Office of the President, John Wilson, who's been doing amazing work. We have the Dean of FAS here, Claudine Gay. Thank you so much for supporting the vision of what Harvard can be and where we're going. I also want to thank Haley Harris and Sonia David for all the work that they do sort of behind the scenes to help make this event happen. So you know I can't be on a stage without starting with the mission. So I just want to say a few words about the mission, an abbreviated version of it. So the mission of Harvard College has been for almost four centuries now to educate the citizens and citizen leaders for society. It's a mission our college takes quite seriously. We helped educate some of the people who imagined this nation and its aspirations. Our students, our faculty, our staff were some of the people who helped lead the anti-slavery and abolition movements. Other than the two oldest military academies, no institution has given more lives in service of its nation than the college. And other than the two oldest military academies, no institution has more people awarded the Medal of Honor than the college. In so many dimensions of our collective political, civic, social life, you will find members of our community advancing knowledge, advancing understanding, advancing justice, civil rights, women's rights, equality of marriage. In all of these areas, you will find people who are associated with Harvard trying to make the world a better place. And like our own nation, there's a great deal that we're proud of, but we also have to recognize the complex and contradictory history of our institution. That many of us who are in this room would not have always been part of this community. And so we have to recognize that our aspirations run ahead of our reality. But we do this through our belief, in our belief and in the hope of the transformative power of a liberal arts and sciences education. And it begins for us with the intellectual transformation, new ways of knowing, new ways of understanding, all toward the goal of developing an independent mind, and then embedding it in this diverse living and learning experience where students study alongside students who are different from them, who come from different walks of life, have different identities, evolving identities, which we believe not only deepens that intellectual transformation, but sets the conditions for a social transformation, our understanding of what it means to be part of a community. That a real human community is more than just a collection of interests. That dialogue is not just simply the exchange of claims and counterclaims, where we learn to see behind each other's eyes, to hear from another's perspective, to expand our circle of concern, to deepen our wells of empathy. And then through those experiences, we hope our students begin to ask themselves some questions. Who am I, and who do I want to be? And how do I relate to others, and what can I learn from others? What are my gifts and talents, and how do I bring them to serve the world? So today, as we celebrate Cultural Rhythms, we're also at the same time celebrating a vision that Dr. Alan Counter had more than 34 years ago about what this campus could be. It's precisely by celebrating our uniqueness and our heritage. And I think this is why Cultural Rhythms is so powerful for all of us, because it enlarges us in the process. It enlarges Harvard's history and its heritage. In a space like this, we not only contend with Harvard's past, but most importantly, we get to shape its future. This is why I have always found Cultural Rhythms so affirming, because it shows us that our uniqueness is our universality. And I am so thrilled to be joined by such a wonderful, incredible group of people today who have been showing us how all of our differences contribute to this incredible place that we call Harvard. And so this year, I have the special honor of making this presentation to someone whose commitment to a more inclusive vision of society, somebody whose life personifies the values of the Harvard Foundation. And I'm honored to do this on the behalf of the president of the university, in memory of Dr. Alan Counter, who was the founding director of Harvard of the Harvard Foundation. Our artist of the year, Janet Mock. Janet Mock started the hashtag Girls Like Us to give voice and power to transgender women. She has written two books, Redefining Realness and Surpassing Certainty. She made history last year as the first trans woman of color to write, direct, and produce for Ryan Murphy's critically acclaimed series, which features the largest LGBTQ cast ever on television and will return for season two this year. In 2017, the Penn Center USA honored her with an award of honor during the Literary Awards. Her writing has appeared in the New York Times, The New Yorker, and Marie Claire, where she's a contributing editor. She was a featured speaker at the 2017 Women's March in Washington, D.C. She serves on the board of directors for the Arcus Foundation, a charity which focuses on LGBTQ rights, and in 2018, she was named to Time Magazine's list of 100 most influential people. This year's Harvard University Harvard Foundation presents the Artist of the Year Award to Janet Mock, and I want to invite Janet up here. Because I think this presence here encourages students, faculty, and staff to extrapolate and question norms and be innovative in starting dialogue on race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, and socioeconomic status. And so we are here marking this occasion to welcome Janet and recognize her notable contributions to the performing arts and advocacy for the LGBTQ plus community given at Cambridge, Massachusetts in the year 2019 and of Harvard College, the 383rd year of this institution. So welcome, Janet.
Thank you for tolerating me for doing the most. And my gratitude truly, truly, truly goes to all of the students who've worked so hard and advocated for me to be your Artist of the Year. I can only imagine how difficult that was to make happen. So I want to make sure that I thank you and give you all of my gratitude for that. And also special thanks goes to Harvard College, the larger community, for this affirmation. It's an honor to be in a space that celebrates and centers our truths, our dance, our movements, our words, our art, and our stories. It is not lost on me that so many of my sisters, my siblings, my forebears, and comrades are rarely, if ever, given a chance to be read and seen and heard so widely, or even affirmed. And as I stand here on this stage as a Black and Native Hawaiian trans woman, I know that I am only standing on this stage because of the work of those who've put their bodies on the line to fight for self-determination and the elimination of societal forces that impede our collective liberation. I also know that the struggle for Black people and brown people and indigenous people must include Black and brown trans people, Black and brown queer people, indigenous trans and queer people. And I also know that our movements must remove structural inequities that prioritize some bodies, white bodies, cis bodies, able bodies, deeply pocketed bodies over others. There are many ways that we can go about doing this work, and I aim to do my part by wielding my pen and my body like a weapon against racism, sexism, transphobia, ableism, and the erasure of Black and brown and indigenous people. And this is what our stories do. They enable us to truly, I truly believe that telling our stories, first to ourselves and then to one another and to the world, is a revolutionary act. And stories, for me, were my refuge as a young person. It was in the Kalihipalama Library on the island of Oahu where I got a chance, even for a few hours after school, to evade the prying eyes and taunts of bullies. My library card gave me, this 12-year-old kid and this lover of books, access to words written by Maya Angelou and Alice Walker and Zora Neale Hurston. I remember crying with Maya as she silenced herself after being violated. I remember yearning for Celie to be heard as she wrote her letters to God. And I remember learning and believing that the dream was the truth, as Hurston wrote in her masterpiece, Their Eyes Were Watching God, the first book that meant everything to me. I kept these stories close as I embarked on telling my own. I wrote Redefining Realness and Surpassing Certainty to center myself in ways that no other book had done before. I wrote it for the girl that I once was, searching for herself in the bound pages of books. I hoped my books would be the mirrors she never had, letting her know that she was not alone. And this is what our stories do. They let us know that no matter how different, how unique, how invisibilized, misunderstood and marginalized, that we are worthy. We are worthy of being read. We are worthy of being heard. We are worthy of being seen. We deserve to take up space on library and bookstore shelves, on syllabi, on gallery and museum walls, on the screen, and on the streets. It wasn't easy growing up Black and Native Hawaiian and low income and trans and a girl in America, and it still isn't. Existing, struggling, and striving in this way shaped me and shaped the way that I view the world. It groomed me to see gaps in representation, rhetoric, and policy. It forced me to imagine worlds where those gaps are filled. It emboldened me to create work where girls like us are no longer disposable but centered, pushing me to conquer a series of firsts, the first and youngest trans woman to write a memoir, the first trans woman of color to be hired in a television writer's room, the first to write and direct an episode of television, the first to have that episode be hailed as the best scripted hour of television in 2018, and the first to book her second, third, and fourth hours of directorial work. Shit, if we don't sing our own praises, who will? But being the first is cute and all, that's cute. But the real work comes when we ensure that we hold those doors open so that we're no longer the only or the last, right? And I truly believe that the act of a person, a girl, a woman of color, a trans and queer person sitting alone with their thoughts and the courage to translate what they know to be true revolutionary, to write, record, create, sing, dance, speak, and show ourselves in a world intent on erasing and invisibilizing, shunning and shaming is a necessary and vital act. I accept this honor as your 2019 Artist of the Year on behalf of all those courageous enough to do the work. Let this be a reminder that your audience and your trophies are waiting for you. Thank you.
That's what it's all about. That's what cultural rhythms is about. It's about taking up space. It's about telling my guy Adam here that we deserve to have a spot here.
Yes, and I love what Janet said about the power of storytelling, the ways that we remember, that we make space for ourselves. And one of my favorite forms of storytelling are movies, in fact. So I'd like everyone in the audience to look under their seats. There should be movie tickets waiting for you.
And some popcorn, too.
Is there anything that's coming up? All right, I'll take that as a no, but that's totally fine because we're in for a real treat. We have a short film that we're about to play for you now.
And this is a short video from Molly Martinez.
I love being Latinx because it combines so many different cultures and different experiences that I really get to enjoy. So I'm American, but I'm also Peruvian, and I'm also Brazilian, and I'm also Italian. And with that comes the different struggles and the histories, but also comes the amazing traditions and celebration.
My favorite part about Latinx identity is the music. I know that anywhere I walk into and Suavemente starts playing, everyone knows that song and starts dancing.
I think one thing that I really love about my Latinx identity is this culture of welcoming everyone.
I found a family here that I haven't had in my high school.
Being a Latinx student on campus allows me to feel empowered to be a part of one of the minority groups on campus.
I think Harvard has created a space that I feel confident in sharing my Latinx experience in.
I think it's important that we take up this space because we deserve our spot here. I don't know, I don't think it's fair to say we're taking up spots that white people deserve because what obligates them to that spot? We're just as accomplished, if not more woke. We definitely deserve to come here to change that environment, to change the freaking world, bro. So, I don't think we're taking up any space. I think we're making space for a community that's gonna grow and keep on growing.
What a beautiful film, am I right?
Again, it's so amazing to watch so many women of color just coming together on this stage and on this platform that Cultural Rhythms has provided us with. You know, there's a lot of black girl magic going on in the house tonight.
Yes.
And now we'd like to invite Molly to speak a little bit about what inspired her and this short video.
Me for sure was at the very end of the film, Anna talks about
not only taking up space, but I think we're making space and we're creating environments that are important and lifting up voices that are traditionally not heard. So through this film, I have a very small amount of identities represented, and there's so many more that fall under the term Latina, and I just wanted to show how badass Latinas are. That's just what it is, and I'm just so grateful to be able to celebrate those identities through this film and for people to let me use their voice in this way. So that's what it was about.
Thank you so much, Molly. And now we'd like to invite the Kumba Singers, two of their representatives, to come speak to us a little bit more about Kumba and the community that it's provided them on this campus.
Hello. So my name's Ayana. I'm the vice president of the Kumba Singers of Harvard College.
Okay. I'm Antonia Scott, and I am one of the Black Arts Festival co-chairs for the Kumba Singers.
Yes. And so Kumba was founded in 1970. We are actually the oldest Black undergraduate organization on this campus. And we were founded at a time when there were not many Black people on Harvard's campus, and they felt that Harvard was not creating a space for them to celebrate themselves, their Blackness, their art, their faith. And so they did this radical act where in 1970 they came together and they decided to make a group that celebrates Blackness and celebrates Black art. And our founders gave us the name Kaumba, which is a Swahili word that means to create, because we believe that we should do what we can with what we have to leave every space better than we found it. And we strive to celebrate Black creativity and spirituality in all of its ways and from all over the African diaspora. The first song you actually heard us sing is called Jainma, and it is a song in Igbo from Nigeria. And we also have the Black Arts Festival, which Tony was our chair of.
So this year with the Black Arts Festival, Gabby Preston was my co-chair, and one of our goals for this year, our theme was envision, how we see ourselves, how we see the world, and how that affects what we imagine for both. And through this festival, which just happened this past week, our goal was to create spaces for us to think about the ways that our identity forms through being able to read other people and see ourselves through them, so have those mirrors, as Janet was talking about, creating the ways to change the world through our art, change the ways we communicate, create spaces for us to exist and change the world. And really centering a variety of identities. Like, Blackness is not a monolith. We also want to represent the creativity of our identities as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Give it up one more time for Kumba. And in a similar vein, our next musical act has also created space on this campus for songs and just different compositions from Mexico and different Latinx identities. So now we would like to welcome to the stage the Mariachi Veritas de Harvard.
Por las noches nomás se le iba en puro llorar. Dicen que no dormía, nomás se le iba en puro tomar. Juran que el mismo cielo se estremecía al oír su llanto. sufrió por ella, que hasta la muerte la fue llamando.
Thank you. Gracias.
What an amazing performance. We just wanted to ask you all, I know some of you have been doing this for some time, so what's it been like? What most do you appreciate about being a part of the mariachi band?
My name's Norman. I'm a senior, and I've been part of the mariachi since my freshman year. I'm not Mexican, I'm Puerto Rican, but I've really been fascinated by the beauty of Mexican music. And when I came here on campus my freshman year, there was an opportunity for me to join the band, and I jumped on it because I really just, Mexico has such a rich musical tradition and connected to its really incredible history and the many cultures that are in that country. And I really wanted to be a part of that and learn about that. And mariachi was the space for me to do that.
Yeah, so my name is Bridget, and I'm a first year, so this is my second semester with mariachi.
And for me, being in the mariachi was really, really helpful transitioning into college because it was a little piece from home. And so, I mean, I hope to also do it for the next 4 years.
Great, thank you so much.
And now our next performers will bring us from Mexico over to Greece.
Give it up for the Harvard Hellenic Society.
Thank you. ψωμί που από μικρό τον άντρα τον εθρέφει.
Another incredible performance. Genesis, have you fulfilled your Societies of the World requirement?
No.
Do you think hosting this counts? I mean, we're really just going all over the world, so.
I wish.
Yeah. I'm not sure about that, but one thing I do know is hip-hop. And if I'm not mistaken, I feel like I saw some elements of it in your dance. Could y'all explain to me, was that all traditional, or was there a little something going on?
Yeah, so we tried to take a modern spin on our traditional folk dance. We had traditional elements, but also a new hip-hop element incorporated into that. If you also noticed, there was also a traditional males dance that Christina and I participated in because we want to participate in normally male-dominated activities as well.
Yes. Yeah, we loved it all. Thank you so much. Now we're gonna take things to East Africa.
Yes, where my East Africans at? Where my East Africans at?
So please give it up for Abyssinia.
Stellar performance. It's so beautiful to watch Ethiopia and Eritrea on the stage tonight.
Yes, yes. So friends, could you tell us how your dance and your group is reflective of both Eritrea and Ethiopia?
Okay, hi, thank you for watching. Our group represents 5 of the over 90 ethnic groups found in both Ethiopia and Eritrea. We wanted to show the beauty and diversity, and even though they're 2 different countries that we're representing, there's still a lot of similarities in culture, and we're trying to show the unity through dance.
So, and like for our dance, we decided to split the 5-minute routine into 1-minute increments of like showcasing the 5 major ethnic groups of both countries. So the first minute was dedicated to Tigrinya from the Tigray region in Ethiopia, and the Bihar Tigrinya region in Eritrea. And then the next 4 were all from Ethiopia, and they were Oromo, like from the Oromia region, and they were Wolaita and Gurage from the southern region. And then they were, the last one was Eskista from the Amhara region. So yeah.
Great, thank you so much.
Thank you. And now we'd like to welcome to the stage the Harvard Armenian Society.
In the coveted land of Armenia, the holy land of Noah, an imminent danger threatened the peace and sovereignty of the Armenian people. But the fearless men and women, united as one, fought many battles, struggled, persisted, and sacrificed. And their unity proved undefeatable.
Thank you.
The nation prevailed in triumph. The people's celebration filled the streets and cities of
Von,
Mush,
Dogs, Kilika,
Kesab,
Lada,
Afta,
Gumi,
and Yerevan!
Absolutely incredible. Give it up one more time.
One more time, everyone.
Yes. So could you tell us a little bit more about the choreography of your dance and its significance?
So, first of all,
you choreographed this yourself, didn't you?
Yes, yes. And it was a team collaboration, woo! Most importantly. It's a big responsibility to represent a culture that has a history of more than 5,000 years. And what we wanted to do with this dance is try to display different elements of the Armenian culture. So for the first part where there's the struggle and the victory dance, that symbolizes the fact that throughout its history, the Armenian people have repeatedly faced persecution, religious persecution, because they were the first in the world to adopt Christianity as their official religion, cultural and ethnic persecution because of their strong sense of identity, essentially, and it's kind of hard. The question is, where do you find the strength and resolution to survive? And it's the strong sense of identity and faith that the Armenian people had in one another, where they subsequently at stages where they were gonna face racial extermination through the treacherous massacres and the ill-fated Armenian genocide of the 20th century, They came together as one. They showed their persistence, their resilience. The men and women shed their blood. They sacrificed their lives, proving ultimately to be triumphant, as we displayed in the second part of the performance, which is another side of the Armenian culture that shows the rich and vibrant community of the Armenian people. And essentially, it was a big privilege for us to represent an ancient civilization whose culture continues to strive and prosper today, and essentially a civilization that has contributed incredible amounts in the multitude of fields on the global level. And we just wanted to thank the Harvard Foundation and the Cultural Rhythms Organization for giving us a chance to share our culture and heritage with the Harvard community and beyond. So thank you very much.
Beautifully said. And it is that resilience that will continue to push us through. And now we welcome to the stage Harvard Taekwondo. Give it up!
What an invigorating performance.
Don't you just want to do it?
If anything, it makes me kind of regretful that the hosting gig doesn't come with an insurance policy.
Let's go.
I don't know if this dress could, like... let's leave it to the professionals and rein that energy in. Could y'all tell us a little bit more about the history of Taekwondo?
So Taekwondo was founded in Korea in the 1940s by a group of martial arts masters who wanted to kind of create a Korean unified martial arts, and they drew inspiration from Chinese, Korean, and Japanese currently existing martial arts.
Similarly, our club was founded by 5 Taekwondo enthusiasts in 1999, and for us today, it's been a really great opportunity to come together, gaining confidence, strength, flexibility, and self-discipline.
Wow. Thank you so much. Let's give it up one more time.
Yes, let's give it up one more time. You know, Jenna.
Yes.
I don't mean to play favorites, but, you know, I have to say it. They're one of my favorite dance troupes on this campus. They're made up of a lot of my roommates and blockmates. And they are bad. Can I say it?
Tone it down. Keep it PG.
Fine. Next, we'd like to welcome to the stage the...
You say it. I thought we were vibing.
The premier Nigerian dance troupe on this campus. Omo Niger! Wait!
She's not
There's
finished!
There's more!
She's not finished!
And the Wahala Boys!
It's Kelpie Vibes.
Zlatan.
Voice of Congo. Beep.
streets. So they say I'm a man so for them. I see them for put it on the beat. Oh, did you call my mommy? Love the way that you want me. I did not do your way so. Are you lucky your way?
Demons, you're not winning this battle. Round two, I'm sweating, but I still get it. God day, so we day. 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 Superu, 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 peru, peru. 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 God day, so we day. 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 Inside God day, God day, God day, God day. So we day inside God day, God day, God day, God day. So we day inside. Higher, 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 higher. Lift his name up higher. Lower, 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 lower. Cast the demon lower. Back, 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 back to sender. Back to sender.
Wow. Didn't I tell you?
You told me. You told all of us. Wow.
So, you know, I got a little secret for you.
What is it?
Maybe I'll just show you. I am also a member of Omo Naija.
All right. Okay. Let's see what you got.
Okay. I'm going to shoki for you here.
Okay. All right.
Let's see.
Think she did.
How did I do? What do you think, Kyra? Frank?
You did pretty good.
You did real good. How has Omo Naija provided you all with the community as first years?
So for me, when I first got here, I didn't really know anybody, and it was hard for me to make friends, but joining Omo Naija has allowed me to, you know, find a community and like a second family.
For me, I'd say, like, definitely being, like, one of the only or very few Liberian students on campus, Omo Naija just definitely gave me, like, a family, sort of, that has a similar background to myself. So it's definitely made matriculating at Harvard a much more fluid process. Yeah.
Yes. Now let us shoki our way on off of this stage and welcome back the rest of our performers for the grand finale.
When we cry, yeah. I
And this concludes our 34th annual Cultural Rhythm Celebration. Can we please invite the members of the Harvard Foundation that have put a lot of time and effort into this onto the stage?
I know y'all can show more love than that.
Let's go! People do is impossible without a team. And that's all, folks. Thanks for coming out. Have a good night. Get home safe.
Take a rocket scientist to know I love you. And it'll take a rocket scientist to know I need you.